You can confirm what I said the other day. That because I didn't want our children to look blue, I had to choose a very light lady. And I thank God for her. Amen. We have had a nice time talking about the Holy Spirit. And I have always repeated from the day we came that I thank you for being in line with the Spirit of God to choose such a very powerful theme for this weekend conference. And just to go through what we say, our text that we were using was the book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8, where Jesus is speaking to his disciples just as he was about to go to heaven. And he says that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. So it's not just any power, but it's power that comes from the Holy Spirit. And the way to experience that power is to be connected to the source of that power. That's why the Bible says that between God and us, there is only one mediator, Jesus Christ. And for you to get that power, you must be connected to Jesus. What does it do, sir? Without it, you cannot receive this power. And we ask ourselves the question, then, it's kind of what kind of power? It is the power that comes from the Spirit of God. The word power translated from original Greek and Hebrew was dunamis. Something that is closer to our English word dynamite. It is a powerful thing. And the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. When we study the Holy Spirit as a doctrine, for some of us who have the benefit of studying Greek, the word there is pneuma. Tell your neighbor pneuma. Now, how do you like that? You start with the P, N, E, then N, U, then M. Meaning spirit. The study of the spirit. And this is about that when you come into it, then you realize that the Spirit of God has long been prophesied. Joel chapter 2, verse 25, the Bible says, and a time shall come, verse 28, and a time shall come that I will pour my spirit on everyone. And think about what the old men will be doing, what the young people will be doing, what the women will be doing, and what they will do from the power of God that they receive. And this power is the same power that was upon Jesus, even to open the eyes of the blind. It is the same power that opened the hearts of the believers, those who did not know that they could give their lives. It is the power that raised people from God. It is the power that can come from God. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And then it's the power of the Holy Spirit that he was at a different time. In the book of John, Jesus says, but I will send to you another helper. The word helper is not being brought very well in our English Bibles, but in the original language it's written, it meant something like an advocate, one who stands with you. And so Jesus is telling the disciples, I will not leave you as orphans, but I will bring someone of another kind. That means somebody of the same status as Jesus. And this person will not be a physical God like myself, but he will be different in kind because he will stand with you and he will dwell in you. That means for some other people who are Christians, you will never be alone because God has said, I will walk you through the power that you receive. I will abide in you. I will comfort you. I will empower you to understand who God is. One of the fears are. It is the power that is working, even to us now. It is the power to experience God in a fuller way. It is the power that enables us to have an intimate or a more intimate relationship with God. Hearing His But you must be connected to the source of power. You see, without that power, we are just the creatures. We are limited by a lot of things. Without that power, we are sinful. Without that power, we are powerless. And that is why we need the power of God to carry out His will and know in our will. How do you get the power? We say you get that from prayer. You get that from laying of hands. The Bible says in Acts chapter 19 verse 6 that Paul laid his hands upon them, and what happened? The Holy Spirit came on them and they began to speak in tongues and were converted. How do we receive this power? By being obedient, trust and obey the Lord. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, who God has given to those who obey Him. And so before the power comes into your life, your heart may be clean. Your heart should be clean. So that you don't welcome the power of God in a defiled package. And we say that when we have the Holy Spirit, He will give us a desire to hear God's word. We told about speaking in tongues as a gift and exalting God. We are told about prophesying when you have the Holy Spirit. We are told about profound repentance when we get that power. We are told that we are going to speak the word of God with boldness. And this can be seen in the life of Peter. Just before Jesus was killed, he denied Jesus almost 3 times. And the cock crew, and then he realized he had messed up. But soon after Jesus had gone to heaven, one of the people who stood very boldly to declare the gospel, and he talked to the people until people were wondering whether he's the same fellow who was just a fisherman, who may not have been very effective in the language that he was using, who may not have known where to put the commas and the adjectives and the verbs, but he was so powerful because he was no longer living, but Jesus Himself was the one living in him, because he received the power from the Holy Spirit and he was able to be bold. Allow me to tell you that when Peter was being killed, he decided to tell the people who were crucifying that I cannot be crucified the same way Jesus, my Lord, was crucified. If I have to be killed and crucified, then you do it upside down. And that is how Peter died. You will receive power that you will, even if it means death. You know, we have come to think about a very loving God, a very merciful God. Yes, He is a God that will care for us. But I said yesterday evening that our God is also a warring God. And so, He said, when we receive that power, then we are not going to be witnesses of matters of denomination. Hallelujah. Friends, I have been a preacher for 22 years. The only challenge is that I've not been eating a lot. That is why you see the body looks to be so small. But I've been preaching and I say, I am now beyond denominations and religious dogmas. You can be religious but not spiritual. Today in the morning, I went to baptize some of us out there. And I said that you can be under the water but not under the blood. You can go into the water, dry sinner, and you come out a wet sinner. But unless Jesus comes into your life, unless the Holy Spirit comes into your life, you will have power not to talk about your church, not to talk about your pastor, not to talk about your constitution, not to talk about whatever you do and your choir, anything, but you will have witness that the fact that Jesus is alive in our hearts. Why does it be with? And we have to give our almighty and blessing to the Lord. And that power you will receive when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And Jesus says something about the Holy Spirit. He says the Holy Spirit will not speak about Himself, but He will speak and put in your heart witness about Jesus. So the power of the Holy Spirit is to point you to Jesus. And we learn some few things at the river slide. We say, without the blood, there is no remission of sin. I had you say that. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22. And then Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. The Bible says that without faith, you cannot please God. You can do other things. You can sing in the choir. In fact, there was a time when I read a story of this pastor of a church that had a very nice choir. And one time they were
were being invited to go and sing in a competition. And the pastor, because he really loved his choir, he would have loved to go and listen to the choir. And the story goes that he died before, I think 3 days before that competition. And he was really annoyed. And the story goes that he asked, well, what would you just give me a dinner in the choir and sing? Then he was granted a wish that the day of the competition will allow you to watch your choir sing from here. And the story goes that when the day came, the choir set up the stage, people applauding them, and then they started singing. The conductor was there doing his solfège and beats. But this man could only hear the voice of one person. Hey, everybody looks like they are singing, but the voice which is there is only one, and it's even out of key. Well, that's the case. And the guy asked, well, what is the problem? How come we are only listening, hearing the voice of one? The Bible says that the guy was that in heaven we don't listen to those things that you listen to. We don't listen to the songs that we listen to, people that are singing in sincerity and with the truth. So we don't have any room for entertainment in heaven. And that is why everything that looks bad, announcement, entertainment, drama, whatever, we don't get it here. Only that person is singing in truth and sincerity. If you stood here to sing and the heavens are there, are they listening to yourself? I can't really get you. Or they look at you and say, no, there's like you can't get you. And so that is what we have been learning. Now, briefly now, let's go to the book of John chapter 6. Because now, that is where I need to speak from today. John, the gospel according to John. Please don't confuse it. The first John, he brought a big problem to our family. Where the husband told to the wife, because he was overseas, and he told the wife to read 1 John chapter 4 verse 18. And the wife rushed, and instead of going to the 1 John, she decided to go to John, not the letter of John. And chapter 4 verse 18 of the gospel of John says, until now you have had 5 husbands, and the one you now have is not yours. But 1 John chapter 4 verse 18 says, there is no fear in love, for perfect love drives away what? What is our theme today? Contending for godliness in a godless society. Contending for godliness in a godless society. How to break through the limitations that the enemy has to. The story in the book of Matthew is a story that is talking about Jesus feeding 5,000. And as we were going to the river, I challenged the people that you see. This heading of John chapter 6 is a little bit confusing. You need to know that the Bible was written without chapters and without verses and without writers. The Bible was just from the end to the beginning, nothing like a chapter and a verse and a title. This is why he started late, to help us in reading. But when John was writing, there was no end. Are you together that? It's important for you to know that. Because he said this feeding of 5,000. And somebody said they counted people and realized that they were 5,000, not counting women and children. What a difficult society. So let's read that. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him, because they saw his signs he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now, the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Then Jesus Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" But this he said to test him, for himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have them. One of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a lad here who has had 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. But what are they among so many?" Then Jesus said, "Make those people sit down." And there was much grass in that place. So the men sat down in a number. About how many of them? 5,000. The men. Supposing each half of the men were married and came with their wife. 5,000 divided by 2, 2,000, 500, right? So add that to 5,000, almost 7,000. What about, because we are told there was a child there. So most probably they were also children. Okay? So add maybe each person had 2 children. We're talking about Jesus. In fact, I was wondering, how come Jesus is able to preach to 5,000 people without a microphone? Have you thought about that? Because we are living in a dispensation that if the microphone is down and we cannot play the keyboard, then the service was not powerful. True or false? Today the bad service was so powerful, there was no electricity. And so the Bible says, and Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples and those sitting down. And likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted. The last verse. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost." One has been served. You know, each of us in this room has the potential to become somebody significant and also to accomplish extraordinary things in life. I said yesterday that some of you in a few years you will not be in this country, you will be out of the country. And you will be presenting us in different places of the world. And from whatever you have been planted, whatever you plant in your heart now, shall be transferred. For the ladies, if you married, may take you even to Australia, even to the US, even to South Africa. I only don't want you to go to Middle East and Saudi Arabia. You will be forced to wash the snakes. Yeah, that's what some of our people go to Syria and Lebanon. I lost a friend who went to ER to Lebanon. And when the people realized they wanted to escape and come back, they killed her and hid her body into the mall. I had to use some skills of research to get someone to read for me all the newspapers of Lebanon to check whether somebody had died in the route, and we found the baby. We found the lady. So it's not about hearing, no, it's about personal experience. So we are having that potential. But the problem is that a great number of people are still caged and enslaved by the circumstances and perception of the limitations that they have in their lives. And this passage gives us some of the limitations that were a reality when Jesus was feeding the 5,000 people. And some of these limitations are putting an obstacle to every potential of what God wants us or intended us to be. Those barriers stand in the destiny. Those barriers stand in your pursuit of your goals. Those barriers stand in your visions of life. The one that the Bible says, where there is no vision, people perish. Maybe for the disciples, when they looked at the ground,
that were coming, and Jesus are saying that feed these people. They say, feed him for this matter. He saw the impossibility of the task was that of man. There are some of us in this room that you have given up. There are some of us in this room that you have thrown the towel. You have been born again, you backslide. You have been born again, you go back on the scene. You try to be a good fellow, you try to fit in. You try to change yourself, you change your hairstyle several times. You change your group, but it's not going through. You are putting a mask, but inward, you are dying. There are people that have been betrayed in relationships. There are people who are even thinking about revenge. There are people that have been even killed or have committed suicide. Yesterday I told the people here of a young lady that I talked to just briefly before I flew out of the country. But when I came back, I found that she had committed suicide using the boyfriend's gun. We are in a very difficult situation. Our world is rotten. There's a lot of barriers that do not want us to realize what God wants us to do. And so we are facing a situation in the world where we are losing what we have had. We are losing even the joy of the Lord. And there's so much struggle going in people's lives. Yesterday night we say the struggle is over. But before we go through the struggle, we must go through a process. People have been told, many people just tell you to believe in yourself and just in yourself and you know what? Just be positive. It's upon you. My Bible tells me an opposite thing. He says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not in your own understanding, in all ways, acknowledge Him and He will make your path straight. But if I'm telling you, you know you can make it by yourself. Cast is the man who trusts in a fellow man. We are limited. I'm saying is one thing that we think, we do, and we say. Amen. So I don't tell you to go and just believe in yourself. No, I tell you to look at the Lamb of God. That God saw and He said, behold that the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Friend, as a result, many people have lost their ground. But this morning, I want you to repossess that which the devil has taken away from you. Yes, you are rightful position. As a child of God, you have conceded some ground to the enemy. Some of you are very powerful. When you are in high school, you may have been even the CEO, chairperson, the secretary, the prayer leader, the whatever. You are so powerful. But the moment you step into this particular institution of our higher learning, you go confused. And you are trying to hide. You are trying to look at yourself that you are never a Christian. The grace of God will find you out. I thank God for the mercy and the grace of the Lord. It is not us that will find Jesus, but Jesus is the one who finds us, because we were lost, but He was a finding of us. That is why it is a song written by somebody called Isaac Newton. He said, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Friend, I gave my life after doing my homework. I had already been baptized in my church. But the time we were going to be baptized, the day before that baptism, we headed to the river with my brother. And we swam in that river and grabbed all the things that would make us not get water into the system. We went after the scene, we got in, dry sinners, came out wet sinners. We were under the water, but not under the blood. But it is the grace. And you know, the enemy is already coming right within our territory. It's no longer about those people. It's about what the enemy is doing right here. Yesterday, we talked about the lost wife. And I said that there are people that are lost within the house. They are not the people who clap around. They are not the people who do other things in Robo. I'm already recording. But there are people who come to the church. But when they are alone, as I said, that lonely, when you are alone, that is the time of definition. You are not what we see here. You are alone with what you can do when you are alone. And that's when you are in yourself. And that's why some of the people we have have already been addicted to pornography. Some of our farm, when you see the people, the thing we like.
They grieve the Holy Spirit.
How can you smile at what grieves the heart of God? We see incurable illnesses. In our world, we see sources, stubbornness of relationships that people think are cannot be solved. We see the magnitude of the conflict that we cannot solve. We see the toughness, maybe of the exam, we may think that you're not going to pass. We see big losses that we think is irrecoverable. We see the rebellion that we think that cannot be corrected. We see destruction that we think cannot be stopped. But in these times like this, this is the time that we should remember that the Bible says, if God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, which giant can stand on our way? If God is for us, what stronghold is invisible in the presence of such a mighty God? Romans chapter 8, verse 11 says that. And so, there are times when we have despised our humble beginning. And we wonder whether we can make any impact in life. And sometimes we think that we are so small. But I want to tell you, God is saying, He's able to forgive us all our sins. For without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. I didn't come to tell you a God that, to tell you about a God that looks like a policeman, waiting for you to say no. He wants to come inside you as a friend. He wants to come and inside you and tell you, it is well with your soul. I will wash you, for the blood of Jesus can cleanse the vilest sinner clean. There are moments when we have even despised our age. You think you are falling down. Sometimes we have even despised our position. People are calling us inexperienced. People are calling us junior officers. People are calling you unstatus. People calling you that you are inconsensual. But it is time for this, that when we feel that we are lowering ourselves, that is the time that Jesus comes to help us to break through every form of limitation. I do not know what barrier that is standing between you and the potential and the reason that God called you. I talk to a lot of high school students, and sometimes I tell them that the Bible puts it this way: we are not the dead, but we are. Then I do, we do it in power. Now, we are not backsliding, but let's talk about reproduction. When the child is being conceived, there are many things involved. Maybe four. One, okay, leave alone the man and the woman must be there. But we talk about seminal fluids and sperm, vaginal fluids, and amen. Okay. And we are told that those sperms are produced in millions. Is that right? That's right. There are many of them are produced. And which one fertilizes? The first one. See the first one? Okay, before I ask you where the others go to, I'm going to ask. Before I ask where the others go to, it means in a race of a million people, my friend, they were calling him short, but I said, we're just going to take a challenge. And the race beat us last. In the race where people were running with the potential of becoming human beings, you won. What does it mean, sir? And you won because you are the one who became the human being. You don't know where your brother and sister went. And so there's no way that we can look back and say we cannot make it in life. how do we contend for godliness? Number one, you have to seek divine intervention. You have to seek divine intervention. Divine intervention is the broad breakthrough of the supernatural on the natural. It's like what's all about prayer. Prayer is allowing the deity, the divinity, to come and interfere or come and be involved with affairs of man. Seeking divine intervention makes the ordinary to become extraordinary. Seeking divine intervention makes the earthly to be heavenly. Seeking divine intervention helps the inglorious to be glorious. Seeking divine intervention makes that which was mortal to be immortal. Seeking divine intervention makes what was finite into finite. It is the point of helplessness and hopelessness that we run to God and we say, "Bila wewe Yesu, mimi siwe." Some of us are so bad, so bad. Some of us are so evil. Some of us are so immoral. And so it was not what we did, but what Jesus did. And that is why I always say that every sinner has a future. The Lord and His saving grace has come unto your life. But I pray that you don't have in your hand when He calls you, because you may not know the time. But my Lord is allowing you. He found a young man who loved an old lady. He found a young man who was so proud of your father. But when he found me, I realized that I was the one who was lost. And that is why I'm telling you, I started preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ in 1996. I'm sure some of us are not yet born. But I think that God told me that your duty is to preach, the saving is for me. And I told the members that I had yesterday that my first sermon, February 19, 1996, was in a secondary school called the Chapel Garden. And I went there, before I went there, I prayed overnight. I did all of this. I walked and studied the gospel. And I was assuming that when I preached this part of the gospel, everybody would be saved. I thought nobody was saved. And I was a very distressed man. But you know what went wrong? And then God told me, "Your work is to preach. Saving is mine." What a great heart. It's a great God. Have you been seeking the divine intervention in your life? Are you bringing God to come into your life? Friends, the Bible says, Jesus looked up and he prayed. Tell your neighbor, he looked up and prayed. I know when people are dancing, I have always seen when people are dancing, they dance as if they are marking their territory like this. But you see, when we are seeking the divine intervention, we look up. And we say, our faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary. Whoever can kneel before God can stand before any power without fear or faith. When you are with Christ and the Holy Spirit is upon you, he holds your hand and he walks with you. It is like a mosquito that was walking with an elephant. I told the elephant, I cannot cross this river. What do we do? There was a bridge. And the elephant said, "Be at my back, I will cross with you." And as the elephant was crossing, the mosquito was saying, "We are very powerful. You see the way we are shaking that tree. We are shaking the tree. Without yourself, you are no power. But with Jesus in you, you have the posture, the boldness to speak the word of God." Amazing grace, how sweet the sound I sing. Bye.
we are acknowledging that all that we are, all that we have become, all that we are yet to become, all that we have come to, all that we have has come from the Lord. In looking up, Jesus was declaring the sufficiency and provision of Jehovah Jireh, the all-sufficient God, the one that owns 1,000 cows on 1,000 hills. He owns gold and silver. He's the one that gives us the ability to produce wealth. Let me tell you, when God intervenes in your situation, things will happen. But when God intervenes in your situation, great things, spectacular things, miraculous things will come. When we allow God to intervene in your life, then the small will be multiplied. When then the crowd's insurmountable needs will be met. When we seek to live in divine dimension, the inadequate will become adequate. The insignificant shall become significant. Even what is considered incurable, I believe, will be curable. The broken relationship can be restored. The deep-seated conflict can be overcome. The pain will be bearable. The arrogance and the rebellion shall be overcome. If you are there and you look up to God, the confusion will turn into a sense of direction. When you are still having a purposeless life, a meaningless life, when you look up, then you will be able to find the meaning and the hope of your life. What as if you are sad? If you are fearful, the Lord will turn that fear into confidence. If you feel that you are weak, the Lord will turn that weakness into strength. And when you think that you are poor, that will be turned into riches. And that is why we say, and now let the poor say that I am rich because of the cross, because of what God has done. And that is the God that we came here to speak about. What would make an advocate of a high court, a lawyer for that part, who pulls on those things, to come and spend the night here? I'm leaving the comfort of our place, and everything is a weekend. There's no compulsory thing that you have come. It is because of Jesus. What can make the head of ICU in a hospital, in charge of ICU, what would make them leave their house to come here? What would make me? I have a stable job. I'm good as a pastor in a local church. For the last 12 years, I have been serving with a medical institute in charge of social science, community health, and psychology. What would make me leave my comfort in Kisumu and come and speak here? It's because we are not the one who is able to keep us from falling. We are not the person that was standing in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We are not the one who was able to rescue Daniel from the pit of the lions. We know the one, for the Paul says, and I am persuaded that he shall, whatever committed unto his hand, is able to keep. Friend, when God intervenes in your life during the difficult circumstance, then meaning is giving you a chance, a second chance to say yes, a second chance to make things right, a second chance to live for him, a second chance to make the world a better place, a second chance to demonstrate the love of God. Jesus said he looked up and God intervened. Where do you look at every time? Some of us have not experienced our miracle. Some of us have not experienced the power of transformation. Some of us have not experienced the turning point because they are looking at the wrong direction and searching in the wrong places. That is why the angel told the women, why are you looking at the living among the dead? Lone moments are the harvest of divination. Friends, we can live to become the person that God intended us to become. The secret is finding Jesus. Not rather than finding Jesus, but Jesus finds you. He is alone, is the one that is sufficient and adequate to help us overcome our limitations. I lost my father in 1983, and I lived as an orphan for all the days of my life. But I remember when I was in theological college from 1997 to 2001, I learned how to play the guitar. And one day, because I don't pay fees, I was sent home because I had a huge balance. But God remembered that He had used me to do other things because I serve a God that remembers. When there was a mission to be taken to Ukambani, and I was one of the guitarists and I knew how to do connect this thing. And there I was at home in Muhoroni where my home is, and I'm needed in Kijabe, where I'm the theological college, and that's a joke. It would be an idea back in the Katana. Whether we have 21. Not the women. For that, it's actually true that my father left my mother in a very distressed situation. First of all, marrying her after giving birth. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 wives. My mother is last. In a crisis now. But God remembers the mission that I've been having. He remembers that there are things that I've done where I've gone to go and do these things for people for free. And when I'm at home, the Lord spoke to somebody at a church from the United States of America, and they called the college and said, we have a budget to support somebody who has been very useful in going to the mission and they're struggling to pay the fees. We want to support that family. And very fast, I was summoned from home to go back, and I was wondering why calling me back. I was calling the visit to come. When I went there, I found that this guy from this church from the U.S., I didn't know about them. I did not even apply. They paid everything. I was in second year. Everything from the first year to the fourth year. Why? I was told your work is to study and go for missions. Study and go away to serve the Lord. That is why, even in the comfort of what I have been doing, I say, God remembered me in my time of need. Some of you may feel that God has forgotten you. You are going through a difficult situation. You feel that you are alone. And you are wondering how your breakthrough will come. Seek God. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all the things you need shall follow you. The problem in the world today is that we begin to follow blessing. But the Bible says that when we have Jesus, then all these things shall follow us. Good relationship will follow you. Bwana asifiwe sana. Sijana niliwaambia. Between mimi na huyu nani anajua kuchagua? Eh. Mimi ndiye najua kuchagua. Nilienda nikachukua pesa. Ndio kwa Mungu.
But when the divine power comes, is there a problem in front?
Okay. I think I have enough voice for that place, right? When you seek divine intervention, the emptiness that is in your heart can be filled. Sometimes you feel that you cannot inspire any kind of passion in anyone. When you look unto God, that passion will be renewed. Some of you, even when you are in a group discussing anything and your friends are thinking about any other idea, they leave you. You are raising up your hand, nobody is pointing at you. Because even the feedback,
you are raising up your hand, you want to contribute, people have no faith in you. You tell people something, they say, something. Don't go with that. Kindly confirm. The ability to edit the truth. Confirm fast.
You know, you have felt that you cannot add value, significance, and meaning. God is giving. She was second gen. Sometimes you have lost your dignity.
trust anybody. You have integrity issues. You want to be popular but with principles. And you become like the official of Yellow Pages. Any man comes and turns your body to Yellow Pages. Let the leader do the work. You know one thing I said yesterday? I think it was either yesterday or the day before. Could be yesterday, I think so. Then you open this book. Thank you. Well, look at these two bottles. One is without the lid, and one is held. Where's she going?
That's the market of that.
If you need water, and you add these two bottles, one is, if you're a pessimist, you'll say half empty. If you're an optimist, you say half full. But all that we know is that this one is a Mungulewa magic of the government, and this one is already. Everybody, they leave you there, they go for the one that could be open. So if you are going out, leaving your bottle of sex, being open from everyone, that's why you have very beautiful ladies and they are not married. Their bottles are being open. Until you are used, you become empty, you become nothing. Yeah, I don't think I've left you behind. What goes around? To others, what you want them? As you open other people's bottles, yours is also being open. Maybe even now. You can't go around being a fool of Auckland and feeling that you are the lion. No, my friend, I can't go that way. Yours will be open. And when yours is open, it can even be infected with the STI and the gonorrhea. And we said yesterday something actually for. By the way, those who don't come to church, they don't know God. Even today, they don't even think that they're going to go to church. Those guys can be very moral. But something I've realized, they can do all those things, but they don't get pregnant. Whatever they do now, thought it, I couldn't remember. Now, when you do, you may have a poker. You may have a poker. You may have a poker. As I come to the end of the thing, I do not know what struggles that you've been having in your life. And I say that the night has been so long for you. And I want to ask all of us, I don't think that God has forgotten you. He has set up the time that everything that was blocking you from reaching your potential, anything that was standing before you and between you and your progress, He has set an alarm clock. And He says, I know when He started, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the one who is able to stand with you. When everyone leaves you, when everyone is giving up on you, God will stand with you. The Lord told me to come to this university to tell you that when God's calling on you, do not harden your heart, but come unto Him. Some of you feel that they have been misused. Some of you feel that you have been dumped by the people you love. Some of you may be single mothers without adequate resources. Some of you may compromise your values so that you get a living. And I gave an illustration yesterday of a young man who the government said, we are going to be friends as long as we are not going to have sex until we are married. And the man said, yes, I'm willing to wait for that. But under only one condition, that in our relationship, I am not going to use my money on you until you are married. Some of you are feeling that they've been left alone to survive in a dangerous world. And because of that, you are very bitter. Because of that, you are looking back and you have no hope. But the Bible says, weeping is for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. When the King comes calling, everything must change. I call upon today that when you hear the voice of God, arise, because the night has been long, but He's able to keep you and to hold you. Yes, He has seen your misery. God has heard your cry. He is concerned about your life. He has come down today to deliver you. And he says in Isaiah 3 verse 10, that tell the righteous that it shall be well with them. God will restore unto you the years that the locusts have eaten. No weapon fashioned against you shall prosper. The Bible says that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord will deliver you through them. Sometimes the Lord may not stop the rain from hitting you, but he will stand with you. Sometimes the Lord will allow you to be thrown into the fire, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they were thrown into the fire when they were bound. But when they were there, King Nebuchadnezzar saw four people, and he said, and the fourth one looks like God. When you are going through a lot, you are broken, you are bleeding, you are wounded, you are beaten. But when the Holy Spirit comes in you, then people will begin to see Jesus in your life. God can allow you to go to the very extremes, like Lazarus. The sisters called Jesus. Your friend is sick. Jesus never came. Your friend is not sick. Jesus is not. And if Jesus tells the disciples that sickness is to bring glory to God, and Lazarus eventually died, Jesus didn't even come to the funeral. And I want to tell you that Martha and Mary were so bitter with Jesus. You know, some of us are bitter with God. Because what God, you are asking, how did God, the Lord, allow this to happen in my life? I believe those two women were really sad, and they were really bitter with Jesus. And that was demonstrated when they met Jesus, and Jesus was coming. They said, Lord, if you had been here, our brother would have died. But even in the grave, he is still Lord. Even when everything looks like you're not going to get your next breath. You have a child and your father is enjoying a smile with another woman elsewhere. You have been called and every time you have gone and see how the child is doing. Even when you think that you have gone into a deep pit like that, God is still God. Friends, I'm told of a story of a gentleman who had a donkey. And the donkey was old, and one time the donkey dropped into a pit and didn't know what to do and how to remove it from that pit. So the villager said, "You just let go of this donkey, serve him for a long time, you cannot remove it. Just try to fill the hole, but it's inside, because this can be a problem to other people." And they started doing that. And I believe that the donkey may have been wondering what is happening. I observed this man very carefully, but in my time of need, he is bothering me. As they continue to throw soil into that hole, the donkey realized that when the soil was hitting his back, it would shake itself. And then the dust or the soil will get down. And then an akanyaga. Are you following me? When I use a changa, don't in a huka huku, and a shake, and I kanyaga. And by, the donkey started coming upper and upper. Because the soil was going down, and the donkey had to move now upper. And eventually, the donkey came up. Sometimes you may feel that the world is throwing a lot of soil and dust into your life. You are seeing yourself being buried. You are confused. But even in that position, that the devil is thinking that you are being buried, my friend, you are coming out. You are coming out of that. You will not be buried. You will have to finish the assignment that God gave you. Let's bow down. Why do you need no way? Why do you need? just one or two people in this world. You're saying, I need the divine intervention of God in one or two areas of my life. Doesn't matter whether you're born again or not. You want God to intervene in a situation in your life. I want to ask you in humility that you rise up where you are. And if you can come and join me here, this is our last service. I want to pray together with you. You are saying, God, I want you to intervene in an area of my life. This is a time that you can just rise up and come before the Lord. He is able to keep you. Just come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that He is here. At the name of Jesus, every knee bows and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. It doesn't matter where you are. Maybe you are seated at the back. I will wait for you to come because the time passed in the proper presence of God. Just come. I know that this God is able. This God is able. He did not come to me. Just walk forward and come and join this prayer and worship team. Can you just move with us all? I know, Father, something is done for you. God left this day for you. He doesn't want you to cry. You are with me.
I will do it, and he's done it again, and the devil has lost.
Baba na uba kubariki wa
eda
kaka usimpo bariki baba na uba kubariki.
Oh, Jesus. Lord Jesus, I want everyone and especially those who are in front here to repeat this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you. I acknowledge that you are the Lord over my life. This day, I surrender my life to you. I declare that you are the Most High God. Father, I pray that you may come into my life. This day, remove my name from the book of death. Write my name in the book of life. I declare that from this day, you shall be the Lord over my life. From this day, I am born again. From this day, I will serve you, Lord, with all my heart. Now, please repeat this prayer after me. Say, Holy Spirit, I ask of you, fill my life. Destroy every bondage. Destroy every chaff in my life. Touch my heart. Break every yoke. Disconnect me from every connection. In the name of Jesus, fill my life. Fill my heart. Be my friend. Walk with me. I declare that you are God. Your life. Tell him that he is the Lord over your life.